Hello students, today we are going to take up integration by parts. Now integration by parts is applied to those integrals where we need to integrate the product of two functions like u into v dx. Now how integration by parts formula is applied? It's like your u times integral of v dx minus integral of ddx of this function u and into integral of this vdx times dx, right? Means this result du by dx into integral of vdx is to be integrated one more time. Like we are having the product of two functions. So if we take this u as first function and v as second function, right? So integration by parts is applied as your first function, okay, like we took u here, first function into integral of second minus integral ddx of first into integral of second, and this complete result, this ddx of first into integral of second, it is to be integrated again, right? So Eliot rule is used here to choose our first function and second function, right? In order of preference, we choose our first function so that the integration is easy. So let us see how do we choose it. For integration by parts, we use an Eliot rule, which is helpful in choosing which function is to be taken as the first function, right? And this is decided on the basis of difficulty that we face while integrating a particular function. So I stands for inverse trigonometric function, L for logarithmic function, A for algebraic function, T for trigonometric function, and E for exponential function. So decreasing order of difficulty in carrying out the integration is kept into mind, right? So for example, inverse trigonometric function, they are most difficult to integrate, whereas your exponential functions are the easiest ones, right? So we should choose the first function in this order so that it is easy for us to apply integration by parts. These days, one other rule is also used, that is your Lie-8. Lie-8 means here the logarithmic functions are taken as the first preference before your inverse trigonometric functions. So you can apply this one also. So start with our exercise 7.6, which is based upon your integration by parts. And let us see why we need to use this and in which questions this Eliot rule is helpful. So first of all, I'm taking an example of a very popular function, that is your logarithmic function, right? So if I need to integrate log x, how will I integrate it? Because it is just only one function. So can I write log x as log x into 1? And I know as per preference, this is your constant function, right? So L means logarithmic function is to be given the preference of the first function. So using integration by parts, how will apply? It will be your first function into integral of second minus integral differential of first into integral of second, and this complete dx means this result is to be integrated one more time. So first function is your log x integral of 1 dx minus ddx of log x, first function is log x, into integral of second is 1 dx, and this result is to be integrated again. Now integral of 1 you know is x, so it becomes your x log x, okay, it becomes your x log x, minus derivative of log x is 1 by x, and integral of 1 is again x, this complete time dx. So we are left with 1 only. So it becomes your x log x minus integral of 1 is x, plus c since it is an indefinite integral. So the integral of log x dx is your x log x minus x plus c, and we use integration by parts to solve it. Let us take one more question, and that I'll take question number 11 from your exercise. Integrate x cos inverse x upon root 1 minus x square dx. Now look at this question, you can find that the derivative of cos inverse x, the derivative of cos inverse x is minus 1 upon root 1 minus x square. So 1 upon root 1 minus x square is present here. So I'll go for substitution and put cos inverse x as theta. This thing implies x as cos theta. So dx is minus sine theta d theta. And my question changes to cos inverse x is theta, x is cos theta, and it is minus sine theta d theta upon root 1 minus cos square theta. So it is your theta, sine theta, cos theta, d theta. This is minus and this is your sine theta. So I get minus theta, cos theta, d theta. So now this is the product of two functions. This one is algebraic, this one is trigonometric. So I'll take it as first function and this one as second. So using integration by parts, how will I apply integration by parts? First function into integral of second will be integrated as first into integral of second minus integral differential of first into integral of second, and this function is to be integrated again. So let us apply here. So this becomes first function integral of second minus integral differential of first into integral of second whole d theta. The integral of cos is sine theta. Okay, and a negative sign is also there, so I will take it outside. Okay, a negative sign was there before the integral, so it is minus times theta sine theta. Okay, dd theta of theta is your 1, and integral of cos is again sine theta, which I need to integrate again. Okay, so it is 1 into sine theta. Now it becomes minus theta sine theta. Integral of sine is your minus cos, so it will be your plus cos theta, right? And plus c. So now open it, it is minus theta sine theta minus cos theta plus c. Okay, now let us pre-substitute the values of theta. So it is your minus cos inverse x into sine of cos inverse x minus cos of cos inverse x plus c. Okay, so it becomes your minus cos inverse x. You know, we have done it in inverse trigonometric function. Sine of cos inverse x is root 1 minus x square. So using it, I'll get it as root into root 1 minus x square. And this cos of cos inverse is x plus c. And let us write it in proper manner. So it is minus root 1 minus x square times cos inverse x minus x plus c is the required answer. Next question, we will take question number 22. This question also requires little bit substitution before applying integration by parts. So let us see. This is sine inverse 2x upon 1 plus x square. Now observe this term inside the bracket. It is your 2x upon 1 plus x square. Okay. So you are familiar with that if I put x as tan theta, this will give me the result of sine 2 theta. Sine 2 theta is your 2 tan theta upon 1 plus tan square theta. So dx is your secant square theta d theta, right? So this reduces to sine inverse 2 tan theta upon 1 plus tan square theta, and dx is your secant square theta d theta, okay? So this is your sine inverse sine 2 theta into secant square theta d theta. Now this will give me 2 theta secant square theta d theta. Let's take 2 outside and I get the product of one algebraic and one trigonometric function, out of which this algebraic I will take first function for applying integration by parts. So integrating by parts. So first of all, let's take this 2 outside. So I'll get it as first function, integral of second minus integral differential of first into integral of second and whole d theta. So this is your 2 times theta. Integral of secant square theta is tan theta, minus d d theta of theta is 1, and integral of secant square theta is tan theta d theta. So it is your 2 times theta tan theta minus integral of tan theta. Okay, so integral of secant square theta is your tan theta, and integral of tan theta, you know, can be taken in 2 ways. Either it is minus log mod cos x, okay, cos theta, or it is it can be taken as plus log mod secant theta. Okay, so I should go for this one, as the secant can be easily changed to tan, and I'll be able to change this question easily in x form back. Okay, so I will take integral of tan theta as log of mod secant theta, okay, plus c. So let's put back the value of theta. Theta from here will be tan inverse x. So it is your tan inverse x, tan of tan inverse x minus log of, right? This secant square theta can be written as 1 plus tan square theta, and since it is just secant theta, so it will be inside the root, okay? So this will give me x, so it will be 2x tan inverse x minus log mod. So 1 plus tan square theta, it is your log of root 1 plus x square plus c, okay? So this is the required